Live from Mannheim, Germany, it's the final edition of World Championship Boxing for calendar year 2008. Tonight, a doubleheader featuring heavyweight Wladimir Klitschko, recognized by almost all ring observers as the kingpin of the division, taking on Hasim Rahman, a former champion. Hasim Rahman's roller coaster ride began in 1998, when as an undefeated prospect, he took on David Tua. Rahman started fast and enjoyed great boxing success until the final moments of round nine.
Right at
the end of the round.
Landed immediately after the bell, and Rahman is seriously hurt, wobbling back to his corner.
Unable to regain his senses in the minute between rounds, Rahman was easy prey for Tua in the 10th. Rahman rebounded from the controversial loss with two victories, then faced Oleg Moskayev in Atlantic City in 1999. After another strong start, Rahman's evening took a bizarre turn, to say the least.
Right hand puts Rahman on the floor right next to me.
In the year 2000, Rahman returned to the same ring and a wild shootout against Corey Sanders. That win led to a title shot in 2001 against champion Lennox Lewis in South Africa. Rahman, a heavy underdog, trailed early in the fight. But in round five, one right hand changed the course of his career.
What a story as Hasim Rahman becomes the heavyweight champion of the world in one of the biggest upsets in the history of the division.
Fewer than 7 months later, the heavyweight championship reign of Hasim Rahman ended as swiftly and suddenly as it had begun.
It's over. Lennox Lewis got revenge.
Rahman's climb back up the ladder began in 2002 against former champion Evander Holyfield. After a strong Holyfield start, the fight provided one of boxing's most bizarre sights.
There is a huge knot on Rahman's head above his left eye.
That is one of the most grotesque things I've ever seen on a prize fighter.
Ultimately, the referee had no choice but to halt the contest, and Rahman found himself with another unusual loss. 4 years later, Rahman was again near the top of the heap and facing his old nemesis, Oleg Moskayev. After 11 rounds of back and forth action, the end result mirrored their first fight, and Rahman tumbled again.
And that's it! It's over! It is over!
After four straight victories, Rahman then faced James Toney in July in a rematch of their 2006 draw. A clash of heads opened a cut over Rahman's eye in the third round, and the fight was stopped in the corner. This was originally recorded as a Toney TKO victory, but later changed to a no decision. The incident, yet another bizarre chapter in one of the sport's most unusual careers. In 2001, Klitschko defended his heavyweight title against an erratic American slugger named Derek Jefferson.
Big right hand from Wladimir Klitschko!
After four more wins and growing recognition as the best heavyweight of the era, he faced Corey Sanders, a heavy-fisted South African journeyman who was contemplating retirement.
Klitschko goes down on a huge left hand inside.
Big thing is about to become the last big bust.
A 2005 knockout over Eliseo Castillo paved the way to a rematch with Chris Bird in 2006. Wladimir had beaten Bird 5 years before.
Klitschko is completely dominating him. And that's the end of the fight as Bird's face is a bloody mask.
Since then, more than half of Klitschko's fights have been on German soil. After a dominating performance over Ray Austin in March of 2007, he avenged a prior loss to Lehman Brewster 4 months later.
I'm not gonna let you get keep hitting with them shots. All right? Okay? That's it, baby.
And just 5 months ago, Klitschko faced one of the tallest opponents of his career, Washington, D.C. native Tony Thompson. live at ringside. Tail of the tape for Wladimir Klitschko against Hasim Rahman. You see the four-year age advantage for Klitschko, a 3.5-inch height advantage, but contradictorily, Rahman has a 3-inch arm length advantage measured from the armpit to the end of the fist. Klitschko in perfect shape at 245. Rahman probably a little heavier than he might like at 253.5. Rules of the bout with our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Lederman.
The Wladimir Klitschko Hasim Rahman fight is scheduled for 12 rounds using the unified rules of the Association of Boxing Commissions. There is no 3-knockdown rule. Only the referee can stop the fight. In case it was caused by an accidental headbutt, we go to the scorecards after 4 rounds have been completed, and you cannot be saved by the bell in any round, including the 12th and final round. Jim!
Pre-fight sequences in Europe tend to be elaborate and showier than in the United States. This crowd has been treated to what amounted to a one-man play inside the ring and then a musical performance. And now Hasim Rahman makes the ring walk. Before leaving the United States, he fired the man he trained with at his training camp, Marshall Kaufman, 2 days ago. Buddy McGirt showed up here in Germany to act as Rahman's chief second in the corner. Lennox, that can't be good for him.
Well, I don't think it's going to be good, because what happens is, well, when the new trainer comes on, obviously he wants to do new things and give you new information, but what Rock will always do will go back to what he knows, and it's like he doesn't have a trainer, because especially the trainer now is going to give him some information. Will he motivate Rock to actually perform and come out with some punches that he wants him to do?
Typical of a lot of American heavyweights in the recent era, Max, Rahman is a guy who was plucked from other sports and came into boxing at about age 20. Amazingly, he's gone further with boxing technique than any of the others in that category, like Michael Grant and Jamil McLean and various others.
Or most other fighters in any era ever, in the sense that he did indeed become at one time the legitimate one and only heavyweight champion of the world, and he did so with a knockout over one of the all-time greats, our colleague Lennox Lewis. He is not unused to this atmosphere, and I don't think he's intimidated by it.
So Rahman enters the ring, hoping to make another big score under unusual circumstances, and having already been written off by some media members who feel as though he's just got too much to carry around with the difficulty of an apparently fractious training camp, the firing of a trainer a week before the fight, the arrival of a new trainer 2 or 3 days before the fight, and the problem of facing a longer, taller, more technically sound fighter in Wladimir Klitschko. Klitschko is adored in Germany, although as he learned one night in Hanover with the disastrous knockout loss to Corey Sanders, all that adoration can be turned to ridicule pretty fast.
Yeah, Klitschko suffers in certain ways as Lennox did, as Larry Holmes did. Not in the sense that he was knocked out. I mean, that's what really turned the crowd against him on that night, the night to which you're referring, Jim. But in the sense that he's a technical fighter who takes what his opponent gives him. So unless he's matched with an opponent who's going to give him something to really fight back at, he's not always going to turn in crowd-pleasing performances.
Like Lennox Lewis, he is the tallest, biggest star of the division, outside, of course, of the 7-footer from Russia, Nikolai Valuev. Like Lennox Lewis, he's trained by Emmanuel Stewart. And Lennox, in several of his recent fights, I had the sense that there was a concern that Klitschko might lose his composure during the fight, and Stewart has been extremely important in keeping him focused and confident and able to go out and execute his style.
Well, I find about Wladimir, you know, he's definitely a focused individual, because when he's in the ring, you know, he does what he practices in the gym. And some, you know, some bad things about him would be the fact that he takes his time a little bit more. Obviously, there's other fighters out there and other people out there that feels that he needs to seize the moment. He needs to impose his will in the fight and needs to go out there and do what a lot of people want to see, and that's knock his opponent out a lot quicker than he's doing it.
So constantly is Wladimir evaluated by media as a process, a career in development, And it's amazing to note that he's closing in on 60 professional fights.
And he's 32 years old. If you look at his resume of heavyweights in the last 10 years or so, with the exception of Lennox Lewis and Evander Holyfield, he's as accomplished, if not more so, than any of them.
And it's not out of the question, if he continues to fight as he says he will, that his career could someday reach 75, 80 fights, making him, in a sense, the ultimate throwback to previous heavyweight eras.
In a sense, that's correct.
Challenger and champion with two national anthems. First, the national anthem of the United States of America. National anthem of Ukraine. Welcome, meine Damen und Herren, willkommen in the SAP Arena Mannheim. Tonight, K2 Promotions is proud to present the main event of the evening. Das ist die Boxweltmeisterschaft im Schwergewicht, Selbstrunden, 12 rounds of boxing for the heavyweight championship of the world. Sanctioned by the IBF, IBO, and WBO, and governed by the DVD. At ringside, the three judges scoring this bout will be from Italy, Walter Cavalieri, from the United States, Robert Hoyle, and from Germany, Manfred Kuchler. And inside the ring, from the United States, in charge of the action at the bell, referee Tony Weeks. Und jetzt, aus Mannheim, Deutschland, meine Damen und Herren, Dame Gaspadai, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble! Fighting out of the blue corner, the Blaue Ecke, wearing black, standing with his trainer, former world champion Buddy McGirt, and officially weighing 115 kilograms. His professional record, 53 fights, 45 victories, including 36 knockouts, with 6 defeats and 2 draws. From Baltimore, Maryland, USA, the challenger, der Herausforderer im heilige Boxweltmeister im Schwergewicht, former two-time heavyweight world champion, Hasim the Rock.
Red corner, Delrota Eka, wearing red with gold, standing with his Hall of Fame trainer, Emmanuel Stewart. Official weight, 111 kilograms. Professional record, 54 fights, 51 victories, including 45 knockouts with 3 defeats. Aus Kiev, Ukraine, zweimaliger Weltmeister, 2-time world champion, the reigning, defending, IBF, IBO, WBO heavyweight champion of the world, Dr. Steel Hammer, Wladimir Klitschko.
Okay, Klitschko, Rahman, you both received your instructions in your dressing room. Okay, right here is good, anything below is low. Right here is good, anything below is low. I want a good, clean fight. Obey my commands at all times, above all, protect yourselves at all times. Let's go.
Rahman has said, I want it, he's got it. Let's see if the former heavyweight champ really does want what the current kingpin's got.
Klitschko looks even more buffed and muscular than has previously been the case. Hasim Rahman at 253, and despite a questionable training camp, looks pretty good. I would have to say, Lennox, that Wladimir has improved his pre-fight glower. He stared at Rahman with what looked like bad intentions throughout that entire ceremony.
It was a definite look of disdain. And, you know, the way how this fight started so far, it turned out good because Rock is bent down low. He's got good position, good balance right now. He's looking to get underneath, looking for some opening, but he throws a good jab. And the good thing that he's doing is blocking the jab. He's not getting hit by any immediate jab so far.
Wladimir goes to the left hook and lands that, backing Rahman up. Rahman acknowledged that Klitschko throws maybe the best left hook in the division. He has a very good jab as well. And he's beginning to land it now. Klitschko has threatened records for CompuBox numbers on jabs in many recent fights, most particularly against Lehman Brewster, when he landed the jab with such ease that had the fight gone a long distance, he might have threatened all records for all weight classes.
Rahman is leaving himself very wide open right now for that left hook. Every time he throws that jab, he puts that right hand somewhere by his waist. And, you know, later in the rounds may give him some difficulty. I mean, look right there. He's throwing the jab, but he's keeping his right hand down.
Why are heavyweights so reluctant to throw left hooks, Lennox?
I don't know.
You had a great one and didn't use it all that much.
I think it's a great punch, but, you know, something has to come before it. Obviously, a jab and a right hand, and you always clean up with a left hook.
And there, Wladimir led with the left hook.
The old axiom is you don't want to hook with a hooker, because if he has a better one than you and it lands first, the fight can end. And I think Rahman knows Vladimir's got a better left hook than him. But you do want a jab with a jabber, because a jab is unlikely to end a fight. But you can disrupt your opponent's even superior jab with your own. And I think, Jim, that's what Rahman's trying to do here.
Klitschko just landed a right hand.
Yeah, and Rahman made the same mistake that he made with me when I threw my right hand. He put out both of his hands at the same time and didn't have no hand back to block a right hand.
No, hold on. No, stop. watch the back of the head. Here we go.
Come on, Rock, relax.
Vladimir Klitschko said that he was very careful to watch only tapes of the good Rahman, watching the best Rahman performances. But he did acknowledge that he watched the second Rahman-Maskayev fight, in which Oleg Maskayev was able to land his left hook with amazing regularity.
I got you.
And of course, everyone in the division has memorized the left hook right cross combination with which he flattened Rahman in fall of 2001, Lennox.
Let me tell you, that was right before Christmas, and I had a great Christmas after that.
Just keep working. Close the gap and keep shooting those body shots. Okay? Relax, baby.
Nice relax. You got it. Nice relax, baby.
Okay? But keep the heat on them. Okay?
Here we see Wladimir throwing a straight right hand right through the guard of Rahman, and you don't want to take too much of this if you were Rahman.
Big round for Wladimir Klitschko in the first. By CompuBox numbers, 23 out of 50, including 17 connected jabs. Rahman only 4 of 39. So the Rock was not able to get his offense going as Wladimir Klitschko, as has so customarily been the case, dominated the round with his jab.
Stop.
Rock needs to go in and hit Wladimir to the belly and work his way in.
Stop.
When he's in, he's got to hit to the belly and then come to the head.
Rahman knows that. The way he'll beat Klitschko if he has a shot is to turn it into a contest of wills. The question is, will that Klitschko jab sap Rock of his will wears on before Rahman has a chance to impose his own?
All of Klitschko's opponents tend to complain that he holds, and it certainly is no secret that he doesn't care to fight on the inside much if he can avoid it, and he's perfectly willing to put his arms over your shoulders to make that point.
Rahman is getting set up for the right hand and needs to move his position. Cannot stand in one position and let Wladimir Klitschko set him up for that right hand, because he's like a sitting target case.
Stop.
Come on, watch that back in the
head. Referee Tony Weeks handled Deloy and Pacquiao last week and made the trip over to be here for this big fight as well.
Stop.
Now,
keep your head up.
I know in the corner of Wladimir, Emmanuel Stewart's going to tell him that to throw that uppercut, because he's been ducking right every time Wladimir throws the jab. Rahman ducks. So that would be a good setup for a jab, uppercut, left hook.
The uppercut is a punch that Wladimir has been reluctant to throw sometimes, though he landed a couple good ones against Tony Thompson in his last outing. At age 32, he seems still to be improving technically and can already be described probably as the best technical fighter in the division.
If you look at this jab, even when Wladimir Klitschko has been criticized for less than scintillating performances, that jab lands like a power punch. It's blindingly fast, he does not telegraph it, difficult to time, and it lands with a real thud.
There again, Rahman standing in one position, not throwing any punches, and you know, this is the position where you need to be first. You need to be first, off your guard, jab. But he's not doing that. He's waiting for Wladimir to jab and set him up. And he's looking to work off of that, but whether he has enough speed and power to do that is the question.
In the early part of the round, Rahman, who tastes a right hand there, got to Wladimir's chest about 5 times, but wasn't really able to do anything while in there. And now, as they fight at distance again, all the advantages belong to Klitschko.
Rahman cannot afford to be hit by that right hand too many times.
It's
outside.
Yeah.
December 16, it's the premiere of HBO's latest Sports of the 20th Century documentary, Breaking the Huddle, the integration of college football. The next night, Costas Now looks back at 2008, one of the most memorable years in sports history. Relive the best moments of the year with Tiger Woods, Michael Phelps, and others live from New York.
What's your neck time?
And listen, keep your hands a little tight. You got your hands?
Every time he comes, he stretch way out here, off balance. You just create a little space and then bing, bing, right back.
And here we see two examples of Klitschko setting up the right hand. And let me tell you, Rockman cannot afford to be hit by too many of these in this fight. I mean, they're already showing their effects a little bit. And you don't want to get hit by this, so he needs to keep up that left hand.
You want a pop?
Heavy box numbers through two rounds. Vladimir Klitschko has landed 34 jabs. Hasim Rahman has landed just 12 total punches. Nothing of any real significance so far. So, two technically pure rounds for Klitschko. And as Lennox Lewis keeps pointing out, the danger is there that a big right hand could end it. Klitschko fending Rahman off with the left, keeping him at bay.
Let him up.
And this time it's Rock who reaches out and clinches Wladimir as they come together.
Rock is being flustered by that jab. That jab is bothering him right now. So he's saying he doesn't want to get hit by that jab. He's keeping his hands up and allowing Wladimir to throw his right hand and see if he can work off of it.
Wladimir just did an interesting thing. Normally he throws all right hands straight down the pipe like that one. But moments ago he swept the right hand behind Rockman's guard, much like the right hand with which you knocked Rockman out in November 2001.
Rockman's laying against the ropes. He's just being an easy target. You can't do that because if you get hit by a right hand, there's nowhere to go. His corner is yelling out to him, get off the ropes, and I think that's a good idea.
I think he feels Rahman does. He just doesn't have any chance in the middle of the ring. And maybe he can lure Wladimir into a position where he can hit him with something with his back on the ropes.
Good. Let me tell you, Wladimir is really pacing him with that jab, and there's a lot behind that jab, and it's a snapping jab, and it's really giving him some problems.
You get a headache after a while, right?
Well, if I was Rock, I would block that jab. There's no need to get hit by it because all it's doing is damage. And you know a right hand's coming soon.
Well, if it's a strategy at all, it's a desperate one early in the fight from Hasim Rahman.
You see, if I was Wladimir now, I would be throwing a lot of different array of combinations. I would be punching to the body to mix up the punches because right now, everybody in this arena knows a right hand's coming. So show something different, throw a left hook, throw an uppercut, and get Rockman's eyes going somewhere else instead of looking for that right hand. And although he's looking for the right hand, I don't believe he can stop it.
Is Klitschko being too cautious or appropriately cautious?
He's being appropriately cautious right now. I mean, like I said, he needs to mix up the punches, throw some body punches, you know, get Rockman to keep his hands down, throw some different type of punches that are in your arsenal, and give him something else to think about.
Rockman pointed out that at 6'7" tall, Wladimir doesn't really like to throw body punches because he has to lower his hands and expose himself to possibly being hit.
Here's that left hook by Wladimir, which is very effective.
And it was another one-sided round.
Very smart. You didn't burn up too much energy. Yeah, he's tired. Now, he cannot fight too good at the center of the ring now. You see how when you hit him with the left hook, before he was missing, his legs is tired now, okay?
Stop doing it. You're not doing it.
Oh, okay? Three-piece.
You're waiting for one shot. Don't wait for one shot with this guy.
I'll do that, man.
Okay, don't let him get three-piece. Too relaxed. Let him get too relaxed in the zone.
I'm going to press him now.
Okay?
Three-piece.
Stay behind the double jab, Rock, and keep the heat on him. You got to keep the heat on him, baby.
Yeah.
Okay, stand on the outside. It's not going to work.
You know we ain't going to be no decision here.
Okay?
Three-piece.
Don't look
take
for the knockout.
Now.
Don't look for it. Just let your hands go.
Okay?
This is a cocoa butter. Okay.
As he tried to listen to Buddy McGirt's instructions, Hasim Rahman looked very tired, even after only three rounds. Harold, how do you have it so far?
Okay, Jim. 3-0. 30-27, Wladimir Klitschko. Jim, I don't know why I scored that third round 10-9, because really, it easily could have been a 10-8 round. Wladimir won it so big. I mean, you just can't do the rope dope against Wladimir Klitschko. He'll kill you. Wladimir landing, piling up points with that left jab, coming across with the real good right hands, just doing a number on Rahman so far. 3-0, Klitschko based on clean punching.
What we're watching here is the best heavyweight in the world. We're watching so far, Wladimir Klitschko against one of the 20 best heavyweights in the world. In Rahman, he's still probably one of the 20 best, maybe on a good night, one of the 10 best. And we're seeing a wide distance between Wladimir and that non-upper echelon kind of contender at this point.
And, you know, I believe that Rahman's still fighting the fight wrong. He needs to put a little more pressure on him. He needs to try and get in there and hit him with some shots, which is not easy because he's trying to duck under the jab. But when he ducks under the jab, a right hand is coming or a left hook. Doesn't really have anything to worry about with the uppercut right now because Wladimir is not throwing it. But
well, you heard the discussion in Rockman's corner as Buddy McGirt accurately observed Rock. You seem to be looking for one big shot. And the way to land one big shot is not to look for one big shot, but rather to try to land several.
Not only is he looking for a big shot, he's trying to allow Wladimir to tire himself so he'll be able to throw one great punch in there. And this is what he feels that may happen in the fight. But right now he's getting tagged with a lot of shots, which is taking a lot of energy out of him. So whether he's going to have a lot of strength left to be able to throw that big shot is the question.
Layman Brewster, before his upset win over Wladimir Klitschko, said he was going to have to try to beat him like Rocky Balboa would, by taking everything he had early and staying in his chest as the fight wore on, which is what happened, and Brewster won by knockout. Maybe Rahman has the same idea here. Weather the storm early.
Well, as the fight goes on, you know, Rahman's getting a bit more tired. He's still getting hit by those jabs, and whether he can still get away from the right hands, we're going to have to see, because Wladimir is becoming very sharp with the right hand and with the jab. And you know, when he hits you with a lot of jabs, the right hand's going to come.
Sometimes you weather the storm, sometimes the storm weathers you. I'd say more often than not.
Since the loss to Layman Brewster in April of 2004, Klitschko has won 9 straight fights, looking for a 10th win in a row here, looking to get to 52-3 in a career which, for his critics, has been defined entirely by the losses and not by the 51 successes. Such are the pitfalls of being the king of the hill.
Okay. Baltimore in the house.
You
come on.
You gotta light that fuse, though. You gotta start keeping the heat on him. Stop standing on the outside. Don't let the guy get any confidence. You gotta make this a dog fight, right?
Absolutely. You took everything you got.
You gotta make it a dog fight.
Your head.
Listen,
and get in his
hands here. Okay? You got your hands too far apart. Hands here, and it's coming behind the double jab. Just let your hands go. You gotta.
The left hooks that you were missing before are landing now because his legs are not, before he could see good enough. Now he can't see them so good. But that's why you're hitting him with the hooks. Before he was getting away, but now you're hitting him with the hooks now. You can step it up a little bit this round. Just get him on out of here.
Tommy Box numbers on jabs so far in the fight. Klitschko 89 of 172. In other words, he's landing more than half his jabs, 52%. Rahman 11 out of 106. Lennox, I think Buddy McGirt is giving Hasim Rahman good advice in the corner between rounds, but of 53 previous Rahman fights, Buddy trained him for only one. So it's really a shot in the dark as to whether he's going to hear Buddy's good instructions tonight.
It's true. Buddy should give him some defensive advice as well and tell him to keep up that right hand, because I can see a left hook right hand coming from Klitschko.
There's the left hook. There's the double left hook. And the straight right hand behind it.
Stop,
it's all
champ.
Jim, you mentioned a shot in the dark, and Lennox, you mentioned it off the top of the broadcast, and that's really what Rahman is here for, isn't it? To see if he can land that shot in the dark, and it's the kind of odds he's facing. It's going to take a shot in the dark to do it.
And let's face it, he does have the knockout power. He does throw a good wild punch, and I don't think he has enough steam or quickness to be able to catch Wladimir right now. Anything can happen. Lightning can strike, but whether he has enough energy to do it, whether he's in great enough shape to be able to do it, is the question. I say he doesn't have enough. He's not in good enough shape to be able to do it. But
he wasn't expected to, and so far the fight is playing out as most expected.
A couple of years ago, in his rematch with Klitschko, when Lehman Brewster was subjected to this kind of jab fest, eventually Buddy McGirt and the others with Brewster decided it was not worth the continued damage, and he kicked it in.
Seymour Ruck tried to attack Wladimir. Wladimir moved back two steps, and you know, Ruck missed his punches because he's not quick enough on his feet right now to be able to catch him.
Before Buddy stopped that fight, the rematch game, he told Brewster, and really asked him more than told him, I'm going to stop the fight, okay. He gave Brewster a chance to show that he had some at least desperation left in him, and Brewster didn't. He had the fight beaten out of him. And at a certain point, the question is, will Rahman also have the fight beaten out of him?
But he had virtually the same conversation with Paulie Malignaggi 3 weeks ago against Ricky Hatton. And Klitschko is getting closer and closer to doing real damage, or so it would appear, to Hasim Rahman.
Well, I'd just like to add, Rahman out in four rounds. And this is the fifth round, and Rahman was at his best.
This good observation.
This is Rahman at his worst.
Well, Wladimir's a very fast and pretty big puncher, but I don't think there's any ring critic, Lennox, who thinks that he is as heavy a puncher as you were. You had the thudding power. He has shocking power.
Yes.
Stop, I got you.
Ah, but we'll never know. We'll never know, will we, Lennox?
No, hold the hand.
I think some people can form an opinion after watching this fight.
Well, what you're saying is you formed an opinion.
Yes, I have. Absolutely.
Got a small cut, right eye by a punch.
December 23, Real Sports looks back at its most memorable stories of 2008, capped by a roundtable discussion among Bryant Gumbel and all the correspondents. And beginning December 27, HBO Sports will bring you our Boxing's Best of 2008, five memorable fights from the past year. Up first, Antonio Margarito's thrilling victory over Miguel Cotto in July, and Manny Pacquiao's razor-thin victory over Juan Manuel Marquez in their March 15 rematch.
I want to wipe him off.
It's a dog fight with him, not Rock. Okay? Hands up, head moving. Keep that pressure on him.
Absolutely.
All right? Don't stand on the outside. You can't stay on the outside.
He took everything he got.
Okay? Don't stay on the outside. Let's not take no more shots like that, okay?
Okay?
One slight assistance to Rahman that's taking place here is that between rounds periods are longer than a minute. They've been averaging about a minute 10, a minute 15, which means, and it doesn't mean a lot, but it means that Rahman's getting an extra 10 or 15 seconds between rounds to recover. And recovery may no longer be an option as he goes down for the first time on a left-right combination.
5, 6, 7, 8. Come to me. You okay? Yeah. All right, I'm giving you a chance.
He still looks a bit unstable on his feet, and that punch did hurt him, whether it was a hard punch or not, but it did kind of give him a little bit of cobwebs.
Well, to me, it looks like he's both hurt and exhausted. His legs are going away, whether from the accumulated punishment or the absence of conditioning, or both.
I've never seen Rahman have the fight beaten out of him like this. Even in his losses, he's fought on until the end, and he... he's been systematically taken apart, and his, it seems his will to fight on has indeed been broken.
He's never been in the fight even for a second.
Yeah, well, this is an opportunity for him. You know, they said to Rockman, here's a fight, here's an opportunity, here's a date. Can you make it? 3 weeks to train? You know, I would never have taken a fight on 3 weeks to train. Maybe 16 days.
Talking earlier about the difference between you and Vladimir, Lennox, seems to me that the real difference people see in the two of you, both big, both of the manual steward in your corner and technicians with power, is that you were tough. When you were knocked down, you tried your best to go on. You won some very tough fights over some great fighters. Do you think Vladimir is tough enough? He's not being forced to show evidence of it here, but do you think he's tough enough to one day be recognized as a great fighter?
Yeah, I mean, he's tough now. What he needs to be doing right now, I mean, he's throwing the jab, but he's throwing just two different punches, jab, left hook, right hand. There's no uppercuts, there's no body punches. Now, this is what people want to see. Want to see true boxing. They're only seeing left hands and right hands and left hooks. But there's uppercuts, there's body punches, there's different combination punches which he should be throwing.
He's known as a cerebral fighter. Are you saying he's not putting the pedal to the metal when he needs to?
Well, I believe that he holds back a little bit too much, where he should really let loose a bit more. Like in this position, he should take his right foot, step over to the side, and start punching from the right side. Switch again and go on the left side of Rahman. Right now he's in front of Rahman. Rahman doesn't have to look anywhere, just look in front of him, because that's where Wladimir Klitschko is.
Stop, let him up.
In round six, after constant sustained punishment for the five preceding rounds, Wladimir Klitschko finally put Hasim Rahman on the deck. Let's take a look at the combination.
And it was a combination like, you know, Rahman put his head down, he was off balance, and Wladimir hit him with a couple left hooks, which kept it going that way, and he just was off balance and he fell down. It wasn't a terrific hard shot.
Do you want to continue the fight?
Yeah. Oh, to the end.
Okay, look, but if you continue to take punches like that, I'm not going to let it happen. All right?
Uh-huh.
Hey, so you know you got to let your hands go now.
Okay.
I'm tired, though. I'm good. In a minute.
Okay, listen. You okay, baby?
Yeah.
Okay? All right, man, listen. Let's go ahead and do what we got to do this round, all right? The ref's not going to let you take no shots like that, Rahman.
We're good.
Okay, you gotta make it a dog fight, baby.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
All right? Get hit with them fucking punches.
Don't give him the shots.
Let him lean on his head, all right? Okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
Stop letting him
lean on get back and he removes.
He's gonna hook your right hands now, you know that. He's gonna let everything hang out this round.
We're good.
Huh? Yeah, I know.
Get on him quick.
Let's go.
Round six was at least a 10-8 round. Wladimir Klitschko was 28 of 68 by CompuBox count in the round, and Hasim Rahman landed one of 16 punches. Harold, how do you have it halfway through?
Okay, Jim, 60 to 53, 6-0, Wladimir Klitschko. Jim, I think he's on his game. I gotta tell you, he's piling up points beautifully with that left jab, mixing in a left hook and throwing a right hand. You gotta give him an extra point in round six for the knockdown. Certainly it could have got to 10-7, he went so big. Be as it may, 6-0, Wladimir Klitschko.
Now Rahman wobbles again after another left-right combination. You heard referee Tony Weeks warning Rahman he won't be allowed to continue to take sustained punishment.
And here it is.
This is over, baby.
I'm sorry.
And Wladimir Klitschko, criticize what you will, he's 52-3 with 46 knockouts. Not bad.
Long tradition in boxing, throughout boxing history, of the dominant heavyweight of the moment taking on a former champion who's no longer at his best but has name recognition and dismantling him. And here is another example of that.
One thing for sure, if you're going to fight Wladimir Klitschko, you better be in great shape. You better be in shape that to be able to take a punch and go through the complete rounds all the way to 12. If you're looking at you're only in shape to go five rounds, you're not going to win the fight.
Let's take another look at the action which prompted referee Tony Weeks to step in and protect Hasim Rahman by stopping the fight.
Well, Rahman's got these punches and he's thrown a lot of different punches, but I'm talking Wladimir. And, you know, the ref didn't want to see any more punishment because there was no way that Rahman could have won this fight. And he looked very tired. He went over to talk to him in the corner, and Rahman couldn't even hardly say a word. He was definitely tired.
You told us in the first round, Lennox, that Hasim Rahman was wide open for the left hook. And that turned out to be a very prescient call. Throughout the fight, it appeared Wladimir could not miss with the left hook.
He couldn't miss with the left hook. He was very sharp. I mean, Rahman gave him an easy target, didn't move his head, and was standing in one place. And, you know, it seemed like a lot of steam has come out of Rahman. He doesn't have it like he used to have it. And, like I said, he took this fight on a couple weeks' notice. Whether he's in good shape or not, he was in shape to go through at least three rounds, but not the complete fight.
You made a great point when you just said moments ago, if you're going to fight Wladimir Klitschko, you had better be in sensational shape and ready to go 12 rounds at a fast pace. Does that, for the moment, disqualify American knockout sensation Chris Arreola, who seems to have a problem controlling his weight?
Well, I believe so. I mean, Arreola is a great guy, great fighter, but if you fight him in a 12-foot ring, you're going to have problems. But in a 20-foot ring where he has to move around and use some boxing and technical skills, it's going to be very difficult for him because he's not that type of fighter. So I don't see that being a good fight for him. I think he needs to get some boxing experience, some technical experience, and then he can really come in, because obviously it's a good fight to see, but it's not a good fight to watch.
Looking down the road just a little more, let's go to Max Kellerman in the ring.
So, Adele is first.
Okay, not yet, Jim.
All right, Max is probably working on getting the interview that he wants there. So here's a look at future opponents, and I'm sure what Max was likely to tell you here is that Nikolai Valuev looms there. Both Klitschko brothers, Vitaly and Wladimir, have said that they would like to fight him. David Hay is in the audience here, and we'll move while we await post-fight interviews.
David Hay, as Jim was mentioning, is a likely contender. He's athletic, he's fast, he has devastating knockout power, but he's also shown a shaky chin at times, and that was at cruiserweight. He's now really outsized by the big heavyweights. Chris Arreola, Lennox was talking about limited boxing ability. I think Arreola has some underrated boxing ability, a deep amateur background, but has not always been in the best of shape, as it's been pointed out. Nikolai Valuev, at 7 feet, 320 pounds, presents some problems for anyone he's in the ring with. He has some good fundamental boxing skills, and while he's not a puncher for his size, given his great size, he does hit with some thudding power. The difference between Valuev in size and Wladimir or Vitaly Klitschko, even as a percentage of their body mass, is far greater than, for instance, the difference in size between Oscar De La Hoya and Manny Pacquiao, a fight you're going to see in a few minutes from now on HBO, from last week's pay-per-view. So, Jim, there are some interesting matchups out there for Wladimir Klitschko. Unfortunately, the most interesting would be against his brother, Vitaly.
And both brothers say that could never conceivably take place. Interestingly, moments ago, you were having a conversation with Britain's David Hay, who watched the fight and is now standing 5 feet away from us. What did Hay have to say about what he saw?
Well, basically, he said, if you can't move out of the way of left hands or right hands, move that head, you know, you don't have a hope in hell. And this was the situation with Rahman. He was getting hit by jabs from the get-go, and then he was getting hit by right hands, and that's a recipe for defeat, because that's going to tell you how the rest of the fight's going to go, especially when you get tired in the later rounds. You know, you're really susceptible for these type of punches, especially his left hook.
We're waiting to throw to Michael Buffer in the ring for the official particulars on the decision. As is always the case for our telecasts here in Germany, the controlling television network is a German television network, RTL. They're really the ones who call the dance in terms of what happens in the ring and when it happens, and we follow their lead rather than to exercise the kind of control that we often have in the United States. So if you get the sense that we are filling and using our on-camera mechanics to kill time here, sometimes that's correct. Now let's go to Michael Buffer.
Heavyweight champion of the world, Dr. Steel Hammer, Wladimir
Final CompuBox numbers in this one-sided wipeout. Wladimir Klitschko landing 178 out of 369. That's a terrific statistic. Anytime a heavy puncher lands 48% of his thrown punches, he's probably been a big winner in the fight. Hasim Rahman simply never in it, landing only 30 out of 207 punches. The Klitschko jab has become his stock in trade, and once again, he was overwhelmingly dominant in this category, landing 119 more jabs than Rahman over the six-plus rounds that they spent in the ring, throwing about 100 more, exactly 100 more than did The Rock, and The Rock's 10% connect percentage with the jab means that he simply wasn't in the jabbing contest. Power shots and Klitschko's accuracy, 37%, not bad. Hasim Rahman able to get in a few body punches here and there, but never really landed anything significant upstairs where Wladimir Klitschko has been vulnerable in the past. Still to come tonight, our videotaped look back at what happened last Saturday night in the most anticipated fight of the year. The fight between boxing's most identifiable fighter, Oscar De La Hoya, and the number one pound-for-pound fighter, Filipino star Manny Pacquiao. And quickly, we look ahead to what's upcoming for the remainder of the year on HBO Sports. December 16, it's the premiere of HBO Sports' latest documentary film, Breaking the Huddle, the integration of college football. December 17, catch the live premiere of the next Cost Us Now for a look back at the biggest sports moments of 2008. Tiger Woods, Michael Phelps, Jimmy Rollins, Michael Strahan, many others on hand to look back at the best moments of the year. December 23, it's the premiere of Real Sports Year-End Special, featuring a review and discussion of the most memorable stories the program has covered in this past year. And for four consecutive nights, beginning December 27, tune into Boxing's Best of 2008 and relive some of the biggest moments from this year's jam-packed HBO boxing calendar. We kick off the new year in the ring January 17 on Boxing After Dark with rising welterweight Andre Berto facing off against Luis Collazo. 1 week later, World Championship Boxing returns as Antonio Margarito defends his welterweight title against Shane Mosley. And every Monday, check out HBO.com where you can find the latest episode of our original digital series, Ring Life, currently featuring three-part profile of Chris Areola. Ring Life, watch it, download it, carry it, share it. For all that and more, log on to HBO.com. And now we are told that Max Kellerman is standing by in the ring with the winner, Wladimir Klitschko. Max?
Congratulations, Wladimir. You barely got touched. You landed almost everything you threw. Rate your performance.
That's what I have to do in the ring. And Hasim Rahman really got punished, and I have to give him respect. He was keep coming, and every round. And to be honest with you, I was expecting the corner giving up earlier.
You looked, in your upper body at least, physically bigger and stronger than you have in the past. Have you done anything different in preparation for this fight?
Actually, nothing different. I think that I'm really entering, as Lennox Lewis and many other heavyweights in the history said, that when you're over 30, the heavyweight is getting better. That's actually what I feel at my age and at my stage.
Okay, your brother came back, beat Sam Peter convincingly. You two are now the top two heavyweights in the world. We understand you said many times, obviously, there won't be a Klitschko versus Klitschko fight. That leaves various contenders, including the man you were supposed to face tonight, Alexander Povetkin. Do you have any thoughts on an upcoming Povetkin fight?
I think that Hasim Rahman is more experienced than Povetkin. Povetkin's a young fighter, and of course, I was expecting Povetkin, that was a wish of Emmanuel and myself, to fight Alexander Povetkin today, tonight. But unfortunately, he couldn't make it because he got injured. And anytime soon, we're going to see Povetkin Klitschko in 09.
David Haye has also been calling you out. Chris Areola is on his way up. You have some interesting contenders in front of you. What is your preference?
I haven't heard David Haye tonight because he's been loud. And where is he? So anyway, I think that exciting time in the heavyweight is coming. We got Alexander Povetkin, we got David Haye, we got Chris Areola, we got somebody else probably. So now it's going to be very excited.
Wladimir, before I let you go, you and Vitaly talked as you grew up about one day monopolizing everything in the heavyweight division. You two are in fact together the heavyweight champion of the world. How do you feel about that right now? Do you wish that you could be heavyweight champ all by yourself one day?
You know, to be honest with you, I do share
with my brother jointly. They have a division. And I think it's even more exciting to do it together with my brother than to do it alone.
Thank you, champ.
My pleasure. Thank you.